following announcement has been paid for by the New World Order.
This is the War Machine Rhino, the last ever ECW World Heavyweight Champion, and you're listening to Damage 365 Radio. Keep listening, or you'll get gored in half.
Esposito's Pizza and Pasta. Check us out at one of our fine locations, 930 Route 34 in Matawan, New Jersey, or 233 East Main Street in Manasquan, New Jersey. From pizza and salads to pasta and buffalo wings, we have something to suit every member of your family. Whether you're seeking to take out, delivery, or you just want to dine in, let us do the dishes, as we would be more than happy to take care of your next meal. Our courteous and friendly restaurant staff is here to meet and exceed all your expectations. We promise an enjoyable experience each and every time we serve you. Try our award-winning Sesame Crust Pizza, our recent winner at the Las Vegas Pizza Open. Visit us online at sesameseedpizza.com for store hours, menus, and phone numbers to one of our great locations. Esposito's Pizza and Pasta, so close to eating at mom's, but without all the yelling.
Hey, this is Bruce Pritchard, and you are listening to Damage 365 Radio. But I need you to know something. Just because I love you doesn't mean I like you.
Hey, wrestling promoters and booking agents. You know where you can get inexpensive prints of your hired talent? Right here at Fast Copy Printing Center, located in the Pearl of the Bayshore. That's right, whether you need 8x10s, 11x14s, posters, long format, or even weatherproof signs, we can do it all. We also can create promotional items for your business, such as pens, business cards, drink koozies, banners, or just a coffee mug. Stop on down to Fast Copy Printing Center, 81 Broad Street in Keyport, New Jersey, or call us at 732-739-4646. No job is too big and satisfaction is guaranteed. Tell them Damage 365 sent you.
This is Lanny Poffo, formerly the genius full of glory and renown. You are listening to Damage 365 Radio.
The Funkenstein Wrestling Superstore, selling wrestling memorabilia from all around the world, including WWE, Impact, ROH, Japan, Mexico, and the Indies. They sell action figures, lucha masks, t-shirts, trading cards, magazines, DVDs, autographs, collectibles, vintage video games, and more. Stop in to get tickets for local independent wrestling such as UWA Elite, CZW, and Synergy Wrestling. Located indoors at the world-famous English Town Flea Market, Blue Building, Booths 45-48, 90 Wilson Avenue in Manalapan Township, New Jersey. Open every Saturday and Sunday from 8 a.m. to 3 p.m. all year round. Visit them at Facebook at facebook.com/Funkenstein Inc. New Jersey's largest wrestling store is the Funkenstein Wrestling Superstore. Tell them Damage 365 sent ya.
Attention, attention everyone. This is Allie, and you're listening to Damage 365 Radio.
The following announcement has been paid for by the New World Order.
Hey, wrestling fans, this is Gary Michael Capetta, and you're listening to the All Night Long Wrestling Podcast with the Enforcer and the Stallion.
It's the All Night Long Wrestling Podcast with the Enforcer.
I believe you're called Enforcers, Gordon. I sell women's shoes.
And the Stallion.
Stallion, baby!
I am not what you would call a handsome man.
I'll kick you in the nuts and you'll smile at me and like it.
All night long!
Long, everybody else out there listening and watching, thank you very much. So far this week, we've given you our 2020 year-end award with Ring of Honor's Vita Von Star, and 2021, was it 15? I think it's 15, right? Wrestle Kingdom 15 prediction. Yes. As of right now, it's 4:26 on Saturday afternoon. Wrestle Kingdom is going on as scheduled. There's some hubbub, Joe, right? A kerfluffle about maybe there's a state of emergency in Tokyo. I don't know, man. They're pretty tight-lipped on what's going on over there. But as of right now, Wrestle Kingdom is going on as advertised. So that's good news for us here in the States, Joe.
Yeah, I think it's the bird flu, right? The bird flu is causing some problems over there. Is that what it is?
You know, I
SARS.
Didn't
E. coli. Was it E. coli?
Where did SARS start?
I don't know. I'm not really a scientist. So I think it's West Nile, maybe. Is that what it is? Is that what the virus?
Encephalitis?
Yeah.
Yeah. Like Black Plague.
That's probably what it is. Yeah. I think that's what it is.
You know what's funny? If Marty Scurll didn't get himself in trouble, that plague doctor mask really could have been a top seller this year, but here we are, right?
I actually saw a true story, a guy wearing one of those in Target. One day. That's a true story.
Are you serious?
Yeah.
Did you ask him where he got it and where you could get one?
I almost took a picture of him, but I just felt like that would open up a lot of other...
Oh, he would have cut your body in half. Like,
yeah.
Trails, like Jack the Ripper. Can we call you Joe the Ripper?
You can call me whatever you want. I mean, it's 2021. I think you can say anything you want these days, so I don't know.
Oh, I learned that the hard way. You can. There's a couple things you can't say, but... Oh. There are a lot of things we can say, and what we are going to say today is a lot about Wrestle Kingdom 15. So Wrestle Kingdom 15 is the second year in a row that they are doing a two-night show, back-to-back, in the Tokyo Dome. It is, as Joe just informed me, a 5,000-seat capacity, I think, as per the rules and regulations.
Yeah, last I had heard, they were capping it at 5,000 fans per night. Now, I don't know if that's changed to be any lower because of the outbreaks going on over in Tokyo and Japan in general, but that was the last I heard. So it's going to be a small crowd either way for both nights.
It kind of sucks, but to be honest, 5,000 people is way more than any American venue has had. I know WWE is really pushing for WrestleMania to have fans, but I don't know what it's going to be. Dude, who knows if it's 2021, we're like a week away from Mad Max Beyond Thunderdome. Who knows what the world is going to be like, you know? I feel like we're counting down the days, right? Like, not to be bleak here, but I don't feel like the world has much time left. Is that fair?
I mean, you know, I don't know, dude. I guess WWE is trying to have WrestleMania somewhere in Florida where they can have a certain amount of fans. I don't know. I know they wanted to try to get fans at the Rumble. I don't think that's going to be happening. AEW, I think, had their most fans this past week. It was a little over 1,000 at Daly's place. So I don't know. I mean, it's hard right now. We're still really in the same state that we've been in. So I don't see much changing, at least until the spring. So maybe there'll be some hope for WrestleMania in the United States to have some fans in it. But I guess we'll have to just wait it out. Just, you know, get those vaccinations and see what the outcome
is. You pushing the vaccinations, buddy? You pro-vaccine? We want to get everybody vaccinated. I'm just kidding. We're not doing that. But if you do want to get the vaccination, I think you should play the video game Resident Evil first. Just learn a little bit about the history of what's going on. And then we'll see what happens. But let's start Wrestle Kingdom 2021, Wrestle Kingdom 15, Night 1. I got the card in front of me. First match of the night, the dark match, the New Japan Rambo, and you and I have no ducking idea what's going on in this match. There's 22 New Japan professional wrestling wrestlers in there. Whoever wins will challenge for the King of Pro Wrestling trophy on night two, I think, but the King of Pro Wrestling trophy match is four. But next up.
Here's my answer. Minoru Suzuki. That's my answer. If he's not booked on any other match, right, for these next two nights, I think. So it's Minoru Suzuki. That's it.
I would pay to watch Suzuki just murder your boy. Yeah, no. Next up, Hiromu Takahashi versus ELP El Fantasmo. The winner of this will challenge for the IWGP Junior Heavyweight Championship on night two. ELP won the American New Japan Cup? What are they? Whatever the tournament was that they had in America.
Was it Best of the Super Juniors or was it the Super J Cup? It was one of those two.
I believe it was the Super J Cup. And the winner of this will wrestle Taiji Ishimori on night two. So it's a tough one, man. ELP has a lot of steam behind him, and he's been very good in New Japan professional wrestling. Again, it's been a tough year all around. But I think Hiromu Takahashi is going to return to form, and it should be a fantastic match. These guys are going to go on absolute balls to the wall, and it's the best way to open the show. It's going to be the fastest paced match of the night. But I think Hiromu Tanbaum Takahashi wins this one.
Yeah, I agree with you. I thought about this one a little bit because, like you said, El Fantasmo has been on a good run, and I think it would be interesting to see him and Ishimori face each other head to head because I think they have been teammates in the past. But I'm going to go with Takahashi as well and setting up Takahashi versus Ishimori on night two.
Cool. Next up, the tag team title match for the IWGP Tag Team Championship. Dangerous Techers, Tai Chi and Zack Sabre Jr. taking on the G.O.D. Ain't nobody realer than Gorilla. Dangerous Techers, I should say. I think G.O.D. takes the titles here. I think Zack Sabre and Tai Chi have had a really good run, and I really enjoy what they do. Their style is really – they're gelling well. The matches are really good. There's good psychology in the matches, but I just think G.O.D. might be the longer-term stabilized team here. So, and it's been a while since they've had the title, so I'm going to say G.O.D.
I agree. I'm going to go with G.O.D. You might know this better than me. Yeah, you probably do. Did they win the World Tag League this year for New Japan, G.O.D.? We can look that up while I ramble on. So I'm going to go with G.O.D. as well. But I guess one thing that I'm curious to see if it happens is if Anderson and Gallows get involved, not necessarily during the match, but at some point on one of these shows. My understanding is that their contracts with Impact allow them to work New Japan should they choose to do so. So I think this would, if they're able to get to Japan, and that's something that is an option, that they, them appearing on one of these shows is something that very well could happen. So I'm going to hope that happens, because I think that would be interesting to see. But officially my pick on this match will be G.O.D.
G.O.D., who did defeat Finjuice at the finals, the World Tag League. Yeah, I mean, there's a lot of question marks going on in terms of Anderson and Gallows, even Kenny Omega. It gives another layer that I wasn't prepared for, so I'm excited for that. Kenta, next up, certificate holder, Joe. It's a certificate versus Satoshi Kojima for the IWGP American title rights. Certificate.
US title shot, is that basically what it is?
Well, for the certificate, Joe, not for the shot. It's for the certificate. I think Kenta's gonna win. Kojima has had a strong year, but Kenta wins, and him and Moxley are destined. I threw this out to you the other day. I don't know where Moxley is. I think the guy might be in Japan. I think we might get Kenta versus Moxley in Japan, night two of Wrestle Kingdom, only because Moxley was not on screen for the Brody tribute show. And I thought New Year's Smash was taped. Now I don't know. Dude, all this shit's very confusing to me. But all I know is last week, Moxley was not in Jacksonville. And he doesn't have to be in Jacksonville until Wednesday of this week. So we could see him. We could see John Moxley there at Wrestling. But I think Kenta holds the title here. Holds the certificate.
I agree. I agree. I think Kenta will hold it. You know, I don't know if they're going to do any funny stuff like The Miz, you know, loses, cashes it in, and then gets another shot out of nowhere. You know, there's a lot of stuff, a lot of options.
Whoa. Miz didn't cash it in, bro. Morrison did, even though the fucking bell rang and whatever.
Kenta. Kenta's the victor.
Next up, Hiroshi Tanahashi versus Great O'Khan. Great O'Khan has, of course, aligned himself with Will Ospreay, Jeff Cobb. And he, forgive me, I don't remember what his name was, pre-excursion in the world. Baby bird, fly the nest. But there's no reason, rhyme, or anything that he should be defeating Hiroshi Tanahashi at Wrestle Kingdom. So I think Tanahashi wins here.
Yeah, I'm going to go with Great O'Khan, and I know I'm going a little heel heavy so far. But a lot of times now when I watch New Japan, I don't get to watch every single show because they do put on a lot of shows, which is great, and I appreciate it. I just don't get the opportunity to watch every single one. But most of the time when I watch, it seems like Hiroshi Tanahashi is on the losing end of things these days. So I'm going to go with Great O'Khan to get the victory. O'Khan, I believe, is part of Will Ospreay's stable now in New Japan. So I think this might be an opportunity for New Japan to get that stable over a little bit and establish them. So I'm going to go Great O'Khan.
Well, I agree with establishing Will Ospreay's stable, but I think that establishment might come in the next matchup, which is the Rainmaker, Kazuchika Okada versus Will Ospreay. Will Ospreay, of course, turned on Okada earlier in the year during the G1. Or right after, during the G1, and went heel. And he invited current Bay, Bea Priestley, and then he was joined by Jeff Cobb and Great O'Khan. And forgive me if I forget the name of his faction, because it's right off the top of my head. But I think Will Ospreay has proven he is more than a junior heavyweight. He's an established heavyweight, big boy, strong kind of guy. Put a lot of muscle mass, and he did not miss a beat not being in New Japan for the bulk of the year. So I think a big win over Okada for Ospreay is in the cards here. And I think it'll even, you know, it'll put him right in that main event title picture.
Yeah, I agree. For those same reasons, I think you have to get Ospreay a win here to establish him as more or further as the main event guy that they want him to be and that he wants to be. And a feud with Okada should really be, you know, this is probably the first, I would assume, in a few matches that they will have over the course of the next several months. So I'm going to guess Okada will eventually get a win, but I don't think this is the place for it. So I think that Will Ospreay should get the win here at Wrestle Kingdom Night 1.
Main event of Night 1. Champion, IWGP Heavyweight Champion, IWGP Intercontinental Heavyweight Champion as well, Tetsuya Naito takes on Kota Ibushi. Kota two belts, Naito two belts. This match is for both championship belts. New Japan, second year in a row, they have had the both belts on the line. It is an interesting match. Kota Ibushi won the G1, but can you help me explain this to me? He won the G1, lost the certificate. Is it called the certificate, Joe? Are we going to call it a certificate?
I guess you could say the –
whatever you want to call it.
Yeah. He lost it to Jay Whito. Yeah, he did. That's what happened.
Every time you say Jay Whito, it gets me. So he loses it to Jay Whito, but Naito says, you know what? You won. You deserve it kind of deal. Listen, if this was WWE, if I watched that, I would call bullshit on this. If it was them, I got to call it here. I don't like it. Naito isn't exactly – I could see, like, Tanahashi pulling – you know, like, Tanahashi would be the guy that's like, fuck it, I'll take them both on. I'm a good guy. Naito, it doesn't really make too much sense to me, but it gives us a good match. Every time Naito and Ibushi have gotten in the ring together, it's been scary. Like, these guys – especially sticking out to me was the G1 2 years ago when Ibushi – maybe 3 years ago – Ibushi did that – German suplex elevated from the second rope. It's just the scariest move I've ever seen. These guys are two of the best in the world right now. This is a really tough one for me. But I think Naito is going to keep it. I'm going to stick with Naito here. How many times has Naito won the titles and then lost them like immediately? And I don't think we can keep doing that again if we want to establish Naito. He's not the up and comer. He's not old. He's 38, 39 years old. Yeah, Naito have a long run with the title. Let LIJ reign supreme. And Ibushi, he seems like almost like the Tanahashi territory where he could lose and it's really not a big deal because he's going to come back and put on a great match and get another significant win here. But I think you have to keep the belts on Naito.
So I'm going to go with Ibushi because similar to like you're saying, he seems to, he'll get a big win and then maybe he'll lose something along the way, right? So he won the G1 in 2019. And then when he went to Wrestle Kingdom, he lost to Okada, and then he lost the next night to Jay White. So he lost two nights in a row at the biggest show of the year. This year, he wins the G1 again for the second straight year and then loses the rights to the title shot to Jay White. So I think that, and this will play into my prediction for night two as well, I think this is the year that they should do like a bit of a redemption for Ibushi, and he should win this match and win both titles on night one, and then get an opportunity to face Jay White in night two. I think that's what's going to happen. I think Ibushi is going to win and win both titles on night one and move on to face Jay White on night two of Wrestle Kingdom.
Can I throw a fantasy booking idea at you?
You absolutely can. I'm going to go ahead and turn some lights on in my house while you do that. So please go ahead.
Sure. New Japan is not known for triple threat matches. Four corner matches here and there, yes, but not triple threat matches. I think being that you have two shows back to back, I would love to see some sort of Shmageki screw job night one leading to a triple threat match for for both belts. Buster agrees with me, which means I'm on the right track. A triple threat match for both belts on night two. I think that would add, in a weird year where shit doesn't make sense anyway, it would add a lot of it's not something anybody would expect from New Japan to do. It's kind of not like hotshot booking, but it's like there's usually, for the most part, a finish, even if it includes Ghetto and Jado and Douchery. But I would love to see like a double something on night one, because you know you're going to get a finality in night two, so it's not like you feel like you're completely getting screwed on night one. I would like to see it. It'd be something different than New Japan really has never done. That's just me.
Yeah, and I also wonder when they're gonna split those belts apart at some point again, or if they will. It's been this way for a full year now where they've been unified. Naito had it, lost it to Evil, lost it back to Naito, right? And they kept the belts together the entire time. So I wonder if they're going to attempt to split them at some point. It'd be interesting to see where they go from here after these two nights with that.
Yeah, speaking of these two nights, let's get to the second night. Now, traditionally what happens after night one is a couple more matches are going to get made for night two. Right now there are only 8 announced matches for night two. 2 of them are dark, and 1 of them is a 4-way for the King of Pro Wrestling trophy, and we don't know anybody in it. So
Suzuki.
Suzuki wins. You say Suzuki, I say... Oh, he's already in this. Juice. Yeah, there you go. I say Juice for both nights. You say Suzuki for both nights. This is because we have a little bit of a wager on the line. The winner buys the loser. Loser buys the winner a shirt on Pro Wrestling Tees, which is going to be on sale this week. So I'm not going to predict the start of matches, Joe. I don't know about you. I'll just read what they are. The Queen's Quest, Saya Kamitani, AZM, and Utami Hayashishita versus Donna Del Mundo. Oh, that's the name of the trio. Donna Del Mundo, Micah, Natsupoi, and Himeka. Okay. Next up, Mei Iwatami and Tam Nakano versus Donna Del Mundo. Again, Sayuri and Julia. Cool.
Yeah, I'm not gonna pretend to know a lot about these folks. I mean, I've heard of some of them. I've seen some of them wrestle, but Yeah, Julia I've heard of. So I'm gonna leave that to Bagu. He can comment on that.
God, he knows everything.
Let us know. Yeah.
So good looking. So the first official match of the night is four-way match for the King of Pro Wrestling Trophy, in which I select Juice and you select Suzuki.
Suzuki.
Next up, finally, Suzuki-Gun, which is El Desperado and Yoshinobu Kanemaru, who are the champions, I should say, versus 1 or 8. I didn't know that was the tag team name of Taguchi and Master Wato. But, I mean, somebody could be trolling me on Wikipedia, but 1 or 8 is the name. That's interesting. Okay. Yeah, Suzuki-Gun keeps it. Desperado has had a really good showing this year, and I don't want to knock Master Wato, but he hasn't. It's whatever. Yeah,
I'm with you.
Suzuki. It's whatever. And Taguchi's best stuff was with Prince Devitt, 8 or 9 years ago. So I'm gonna go with Suzuki-Gun here.
Yeah, I'm gonna agree with you for all those same reasons. I think Suzuki-Gun should get the win, so I'm going to go with them.
Next up, this is going to fucking rule. It's going to beat the shit out of you if you're watching it. You're going to get hit in the face. Shingo Takagi, never open weight champion, defending his title against Jeff Cobb. Man, with the G1 last year when Jeff Cobb was in it, I thought he was going to make a bigger splash than he did. I thought maybe the U.S. love and appreciation for Jeff Cobb would have carried over into New Japan, but it didn't seem like they were maybe as high on him as America was, because he took a lot of clean pinfall losses, which I mean, I have no problem with. I just expected more of a maybe some more wins for Jeff Cobb. That being said, I think Shingo is one of the absolute best wrestlers in the world. Can't miss. Just every single match is great. I don't want to see him lose here at all. Unfortunately, I think I'm going to see him lose here, and I'm going to see him lose clean and lose the never open weight title to further establish Will Ospreay's group. So I think Jeff Cobb gets a clean duke over Shingo.
Yes, the Empire apparently is the name of Ospreay's group, by the way. I just wanted to throw that in there.
You a big fan of Roman?
I think he would have to be, right? I mean, how could you not be? I agree. I think Jeff Cobb wins for the same reason. So, I mean, I'm predicting that Ospreay and Cobb and Great O'Conn and all these guys win their matches this weekend. I'm not sure if that'll happen, but I'm going to also go with Jeff Cobb. I think he had a great showing to me in the G1 this year, and he's I think, overdue for another title run here in New Japan. So I'm going to go with Jeff Cobb, as they say.
Next up, the battle of LIJ, well, former battle of LIJ, battle of former LIJ guy, Evil versus Sonata. A year and a half ago, I would have had a much different take on this match. I was a big Evil guy, love Evil. Not so high on Sonata. Boy, how times have changed. I'm so sick of the ghetto, Jado, just bullshit. I'm so tired of it. Evil's matches have been terrible, and I'm not going to necessarily blame him. It's just the booking, the Kenta stuff and the Jay White stuff. It's overdone. If you have like one of those guys doing it with all the interference and the run-ins and shit, it's okay. But when you have so many, like if you were to put those three guys, like Kenta, Jay White, and Evil, and like you asked me to rank them in importance, Evil's at the bottom, right? Even though he had the title, like he just He's a better tag wrestler, I think, than he is a singles wrestler. He had a defining win over Okada a couple of years back, and I was like, oh, this is going to be like the difference for Evil. And I think Evil would have made more sense coming out of LIJ than going to the Bullet Club, because it just doesn't sit well. It doesn't really do it for me. It doesn't cook the turkey in the oven, Joe. Turkey's not brine, buddy. So I'm going to go with Sonata here based out of spite, because this Evil shit sucks. So I'm going to go with Sonata.
Yeah, it's funny, actually, because I was going to say I'm going with Sonata just because I want Sonata to win. So normally I try to make a prediction based off of storyline or what makes sense or what I think they're going to do, but I'm just picking Sonata because I want to see Sonata win. I agree with you about Evil. I was always pro Sonata over Evil in terms of comparison. But I did recognize that Evil was improving. I thought, at least to me, he was, and it, you know, his gimmick, his character seemed to be very over with the audience when he was still in LIJ. I thought that was pretty cool. And of course, they changed all that up when he left and joined Bullet Club, which I guess you kind of have to do to a certain extent, right? Because you want to kind of give him a different look and feel. I just think that one of the things that 2020, as far as New Japan, will be remembered for me is I think that the Evil title win over Naito was a bit of a misfire on their part. I understand what they were trying to do, right? You want to make another main event level heel, you know, catapult Evil into that level. It didn't go as good as I think it should have gone. The matches he had with Naito were not great. So to me, his stock has dropped a little bit now. And
if you can't have a good match with Naito, who can you have a good match with?
Yeah, and like you said earlier, a lot of that Bullet Club interference stuff, it just kind of gets a little bit old with the Dick Togo stuff now. So anyway, I'm going to go with Sonata as well. I'll be pulling for Sonata to win as much as anybody this weekend, so go Sonata.
What do you think he orders when he's at the drive-thru? Dick to go.
This is really not what I expected.
But to be fair about this Bullet Club interference, like, you're going to see it on the card. If you have Kenta, Jay White, and Evil on the card, you're going to see it three times. And when Evil was in the main event, but it was the third time you saw it, you're like, all right, I'm tired of this shit. I get it. Whatever. Like, when the Bucks were heels with Omega and the Elite, like, it would be sporadic, few and far between, and you wouldn't see it so much every night, which is why, like, when he does it, you're like, oh, that's a dick heel move. Not like, all right, this is all you have to fall back on to get these guys over his heels, if that makes sense. Next up, Taiji Ishimori versus the winner of the match on night one between Hiromu Tanbaum, Takahashi, and ELP. You and I both, you went with Takahashi, right? Yeah.
Yes.
So last year, Hiromu Takahashi defeated Will Ospreay for the IWGP Junior Heavyweight Championship. Ishimori has been a good champion, but I'm still going with my man Hiromu here. I think he's probably the best wrestler in the junior heavyweight division, and I like Taiji Ishimori, but is it me? It just kind of feels like he's missing something. Is it just me?
I think maybe there are other guys in the division that you could say have a little bit more in terms of charisma than him. But I think he's an excellent wrestler, as you said. I think he's a solid champion, whether as a singles champion or a tag champion. But I agree. I'm going to go with Hiromu to win here. I almost kind of feel like Hiromu is slotting into the role of what Kushida used to be in the junior heavyweight division, where, like, Kushida was kind of the featured babyface for a long time, would always find himself in these junior heavyweight title matches, especially at Wrestle Kingdom. I'm not sure if that's what they're going for, but it feels a little bit like that with Hiromu. So I'm going to say that Hiromu wins this match and the title on night two.
Okay. Main event of the night, Tetsuya Naito or Kota Ibushi taking on Jay White, the briefcase holder, the certificate holder that defeated Kota Ibushi previously this year for the belt, for the briefcase. I have Tetsuya Naito. You have Kota Ibushi. I think Tetsuya Naito is going to walk out as champion of champ, Naito two belts of night two as kind of what you said in regards to like a redemption, but Naito has been, he could win the big one, but he can't hold on to it. And I think beating Kota Ibushi and Jay White back-to-back nights would dispel that stigma. So I'm going to say Naito keeps the belt here.
Yeah, I guess similarly, I'm going to go with Ibushi to win this match as well. And I think that, again, listen, I have no idea what Ghetto is planning to do. I just think that it would be cool as a story of, you know, Ibushi wins the G1 in 2019, loses both nights at Wrestle Kingdom last year. This year he wins G1 in 2020, loses his opportunity at the title shot, and then Naito goes ahead and gives him a shot. He'll win it on night one, and then I think he'll get revenge on Jay White in night two and walk away as the double champion, double gold, I think is what it's called.
Double gold.
Yeah, so I think that's what they should do. Ibushi, I believe, is about the same age as Naito or very close to it. So, you know, he's been back with New Japan for a couple of years now. I think he signed like what amounts to a lifetime contract with them. I think he's at the top of his game. What's that?
They're both 38.
Yeah, there you go. So I think he's at the top of his game. And, you know, a guy wins G1 2 years in a row. I feel like it's the time to put the title on him. You know, it doesn't look like they're going to go back to Okada right away unless, you know, they set things up coming out of these shows. Good point. I think it'll be good to put it on Ibushi, and you can work with some programs from there. Maybe he works with Ospreay in a title program at some point during the year. You know, there's, of course, there's, you know, Evil. There's other guys that he can work with as a babyface. So I'm going to say that Ibushi ends up, you know, the champion at the end of these two nights, and it's really all about you know, him walking out as the top guy of New Japan after this weekend.
That's a good point. The fact that Ibushi would have won two G1s in a row and not captured the title. So I really honestly didn't even take that. I looked at it as a singular match and what I would do, but I could definitely see the storyline where it would kind of culminate. And I think that would tell a really good story. You know, night two is a little weird because there's so much we don't really know that's from night one, a lot of the matches. Also, night two, I mean, you're missing the ace. You're missing Tanahashi. I don't see any Kenta on the card, which is okay. I don't see any Ishii on the card. Like you mentioned, there's no Suzuki. But I guess when you have shortened cards with the new normal, whatever kind of bullshit people are going to call it, like you're not going to have 15 match cards that go on 5 hours with 40 people in the New Japan Rumble and shit like that. So it's definitely going to be a different experience. I'm interested to see if we're going to get any of those surprises that we talked about. I know New Year's Dash is coming up right after that, which is really where everything for the new year kicks off. But on paper, there are some very, very interesting, very intriguing matchups this year.
Yeah, I think you're right on with all that. It's a different, you know, kind of year. It's going to be a different atmosphere. The cards are shorter. But I guess you got to just go forward with whatever, you know, booking plans they have, with the expectation that hopefully by, like, you know, the middle of the year, they'll be back to having, you know, regular shows and regular fans. So I think that's, you know, and I think there's still also some intrigue in terms of who's going to win. We have different choices for who's going to walk away out as the champion, both, you know, night one, night two. So there's a lot of different things that can happen there. There's definitely a lot of intrigue for me in that regard. I think that the show itself is probably lacking a little bit of the buzz that it's had in years past. But, you know, again, there's not going to be 40,000 people in the dome. There's not going to be, you know, 10 matches. But they've done a good enough job of getting some of the big programs out there. And the matches on paper, like you said, should be very good. And I would expect them to deliver on the 4th and the 5th when these cards take place.
Yeah, the buzz, even like the buzz hasn't been there, but not for lack of trying, because they had the World Tag League. They had the Best of Super Juniors. They have the Fighting Spirit show on Friday, or whatever they call the Friday night show in America. Like they're doing the best they can, all things considered. I think the world is just in such a shitty place for some people. It's tough to focus on that, but I guarantee Tuesday afternoon, whatever the show is going to be over, people are going to be talking about it. And I don't know. I just have a feeling we're going to be in for some surprises and some good wrestling. Did you want to recap SmackDown from last night?
No, I don't think so. I don't think so. I mean, if anybody wants us to, they can tweet us and say, hey guys, we really want to hear SmackDown reviews every week.
More Sonya Deville is what we're getting at.
Yeah. Yeah. That type of
not
thing.
Not too much Sonya Deville, but like a little bit of Sonya Deville.
A little bit of Sonya Deville.
Yeah. And if you want to tweet us, you can do so at the all, oh, I'm sorry, at all night long WP, all over your social medias, your Instagram, your Twitter, Facebook.com/allnightlongwp. And make sure you go to YouTube.com and follow our friends over at Wrestling Headlines as they take care of us and they host all of our podcasts over there. We very much appreciate them. And if you're in the mood for some swag, it's the holiday season, you got some extra cash burning a hole in your pocket, go to our friends over at Born Scum Clothing Company. Use the promo code all night long. I'm giving Instagram handles now, Joe. All night long, take 10% off. You want hats, you want hoodies, tank tops, soap on a rope. They got it all. Born Scum Clothing Company. And be sure to follow us along, like I said, on Twitter. We'll be talking all week about Wrestle Kingdom. And Joe, what did I miss? I feel like I missed something.
No, I think you got it all, buddy.
That was it. You sure you don't want to talk more about SmackDown?
No, I'm sure. Yep, I'm good.
What about the Miami Vice podcast you and I were talking about?
I think, you know, I don't know, man. I was kind of putting it out. Someone had done a Miami Vice podcast, like episode by episode. I sent it to Mikey, hoping that he would maybe have interest in starting up his own Miami Vice podcast.
I thought we were going to start the Miami Vice podcast.
Oh, okay. Well, I mean, if people are interested in that, then absolutely. We could see if we can get Don Johnson on.
DJ, my man.
You know.
Phil Michael Thomas. God, he's – if nothing, I think we should start dressing like them. When you know what? Let's make this decree. Right now, January 2nd, 2021, the first wrestling show in New York – that you and I can attend in person, we will dress like Crockett and Tubbs. Can I get a virtual handshake? I'll wear fucking salmon undershirt, white loafers, white sports coat, Sperry boat shoes, and you have to dress like Ricardo Tubbs.
Yeah, I'm in. That's not even – no hesitation.
All you need is to be black and a jerry curl. And, okay. He usually wears like blue, kind of like a denim-y look. If you can get a jerry curl by then, you and I will be at shows like Crockett and Tubbs. It'll look like when everybody dressed up like the Horsemen in the 80s.
Yeah. I think my girlfriend has like a curling iron or something. So I can probably, if I just let it grow out a little bit and then I can just, you know, curl it up and workshop some suit and shirt combinations. And I just need one of those comfortable pairs of shoes that you talked about and I should be good to go.
Yeah, I'll get you some of them Sperry's, and I forget what they put in there. Like maybe like motor oil in the hair. It's all deadly. It's 2021 is the new 1986. That's how I look at it. And before we really get going on this Miami Vice podcast, we're gonna let you guys go. We thank you for checking out the All Night Long Wrestling Podcast. And he's the Stallion. I'm the Enforcer, and we're tapping out.